How'd you like to listen to .NET Rocks with no ads? Easy. Become a patron. For just $5 a month, you get access to a private RSS feed where all the shows have no ads. $20 a month will get you that and a special .NET Rocks patron mug. Sign up now at patreon.dotnetrocks.com.
Hey there. This is Jeff Fritz, the purple blazer guy from Microsoft, letting you in on a little secret about my friend Carl Franklin. You know, the guy who started .NET Rocks, the first podcast about .NET. In 2002, the guy who's been teaching Blazor on YouTube since 2020. Yeah, that Carl Franklin. Well, Carl's joined up with the folks from Code in a Castle to teach a week-long hands-on Blazor class at, are you ready? Get this, at a castle/villa in Tuscany. It's sort of a luxury vacation with Blazor learning built in. Carl's calling it the Blazor Master Class. You'll learn Blazor from the ground up, finishing the week with the ability to build and deploy Blazor applications. Since the training happens for only 4 hours in the morning over 6 days, you can bring your significant other, your partner with you, and you should, right? This part of Italy is absolutely beautiful. There's so much to see and do, and Larry and Marco from Code in a Castle are organizing daily activities both at the castle and in the area. The castle is in the Maremma, a less touristed region of Tuscany, offering both classic Tuscan hill country, as well as easy access to the Etruscan Riviera with sublime local food, wine, and olive oil around every corner. Breakfast is included every day. There will be 2 communal dinners at the castle bookending the experience, and most other meals and all activities are included. And did I mention you'll learn Blazor in person from Carl Franklin? Listen, space is limited and for very good reason. This is quality training in a beautiful setting. Go to codeinacastle.com/blazor2023. That's BLAZOR2023 to take advantage of this amazing opportunity to join Carl in Tuscany for an unforgettable week of La Dolce Vita while advancing your programming skills in this important new technology.
After building software for a while, you know it's only a matter of time before you see an HTTP timeout or a database deadlock. In software, it's not a case of if things fail, but a case of when. One mishap like this and valuable data is lost forever. And these failures occur all the time. But it doesn't have to be this way. Introducing nService Bus, the ultimate tool to build robust and reliable systems that can handle failures gracefully, maintain high availability, and scale to meet growing demand. For more than 15 years, nService Bus has been trusted to run mission-critical systems that must not go down or lose any data ever. And now you can try it for yourself. nService Bus integrates seamlessly with your .NET applications and can be hosted on-premises or in the cloud. Say goodbye to lost data and system failures, and say hello to a better, more reliable way of building distributed systems. Try nService Bus today by heading over to go.particular.net/.NET Rocks and start building better systems with asynchronous messaging using nService Bus. Welcome back to .NET Rocks. This is Carl Franklin.
And it's Richard Campbell.
And Mark Miller is here joining us.
It's been a while since we've...
Nothing! I keep telling you, nothing is going to go wrong on this show.
It is not going to be Mondays, however. This is clearly .NET Rocks. But we'll talk to Mark in a minute. But first of all, buddy, how you doing?
I'm all right. Things are good up here. We're, getting organized and knocking out a few shows.
Is your air clean?
Yeah, you know, it's nice being on the West Coast where the wind comes off the ocean.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a forest fire, you know, it's forest fire season started very early here.
Yeah.
So there is a fire inland a bit, and it's creeping, depending on how the wind flow goes, it creeps in a little bit closer, but it's all right there.
New York City got hammered, but we sort of were on the outskirts of it.
Yeah.
But we still had over 200, 250
poor air quality index.
Well, we're evacuating towns that are burning to the ground and trying to save lives. So
yeah,
breathe carefully while we try and not kill everybody.
Yeah, that's true. Good luck up there.
Yeah, the good news is the U.S. is sending firefighters and water bombers. Like, we all help each other during the... Yep. It's convenient for us to have our season early, so when your later season arrives, we're available to help out.
That's so awesome.
Thank you for that.
Yes. It's part of the system.
All right, well, let's roll the crazy music for a little thing we call Beta Noah Framework.
Awesome. All right, man, what do you got?
Well, you probably heard Jeff Fritz in the introduction there talking about this crazy idea that a friend of mine had to rent a castle in Tuscany and have a week-long training class there in Blazer. And I sort of coined the term traincation.
Yeah.
Because it's just as much a vacation with sightseeing and touristy stuff as it is training. In fact, the training is only for 4 hours a day for 6 days. And the rest of the time, you get guided tours of the surrounding area. So the only problem, I think, is that it's a little pricey. You kind of have to consider it both training budget and vacation budget.
Right, yeah.
So.
Yeah, well, Tuscany's not cheap. And flying's certainly not cheap these days, that's for sure.
It's not. Yeah, it's not cheap. And the other thing is that you can't just... This castle is not a hotel. It's a villa that you have to rent the whole thing.
Right.
For a week at a time. And that's completely outside the range of most people's ability, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's it. It's at codingacastle.com/blazer2023.
Cool.
And today, when this comes out, is the end of the deadline for the early bird discount. So you'll have to pay full price. But we need to get... You know who's interested in going, Richard?
Who's going?
Our friend Scott Hunter.
That's fun.
He's not committed yet. But he said there are a couple of things have to work out, and then he's there.
That's cool. Yeah, well.
Yeah.
I'm committed to playing Nosferatu and hiding in the shadows and scaring the people trying to learn.
All the basics, really.
I sent in my confirmation, Carl. I know you didn't ask, but I sent you that confirmation.
Okay. Great. It is Mondays, isn't it? All right, well.
Might just be, yeah.
Might just be. So, Richard, you got a comment for us? Who's talking to us?
I grabbed a comment off show 1848, which is the one we did at Techorama in Antwerp with Dr. Jody Burchell.
Mm-hmm.
It's from, and I figure since we were talking about large language models, with her, I suspect we're going to talk a little bit about large language models today. It kind of made sense.
Yeah.
And so Nick Azagarian said, this is an excellent episode. I really like the idea of using AI to validate and verify an AI. Yeah, that's an arms race for you right there.
Mm.
And understand why it's never going to be able to be used long term or even now. We'll see. I think one possible regulation would be similar to other rights. AI generated visuals like images and movies should have a watermark that can be tracked.
Mm-hmm.
And players can display that the images are flagged when an image has been modified or show an info link to the prompt that generated it. Yeah, I wonder if AI tools could just detect that in the first place, may or may not need a watermark. They kind of leave watermarks anyway because of the way they make their images.
Hmm.
This would be similar to today's copy machines, not being able to copy currency or only being able to display Blu-ray content versus an HDMI content protected cable. Boy, we love that feature. Remember
yeah.
content protection? That was the best.
Oh, boy, that was the best.
Look how popular that is today.
Yeah. They should bring that back, Razor.
There you go. Yeah, bring back copy protection Blu-rays. Oh, boy. I think that AI overall is going to have a huge benefit to mankind, but only if there are appropriate regulations. I think a top secret committee could be created that inventors could divulge their planned inventions to regulators to be ready at launch, but IP could be protected via NDAs.
Mm.
I think that's what patents are for, actually, Nick. Like, they, you know,
that
way you can divulge the stuff, but if anybody uses it, they get to pay you. Anyway, I mean, I appreciate that folks are thinking about how we're going to manage this stuff. I also think we're in the midst of a really serious hype cycle that's distorting reality pretty heavily.
Yeah.
And that hype cycle will pass.
Yep. Yeah, it will.
So, Nick, thank you so much for your comment. And a copy of Music Code By is on its way to you. And if you'd like a copy of Music Code By, write a comment on the website at .NETROCKS.com or on the Facebooks. Publish every show there. And if you comment there and I read it on the show, we'll send you a copy of Music Code By.
And you can follow us on Twitter if you want to, but the real fun happens over on Mastodon. I'm at Carl Franklin at techhub.social.
And I'm Rich Campbell at mastodon.social.
And yeah, send us a toot. We like to hear from you over there. Hey, before I introduce Mark, I you were talking about the watermarks there,
mm-hmm.
and you know how we can identify images. It's very easy to identify. Just look for people shaking hands and the fingers are all fused together, or extra digits,
creepy stuff, or an extra ear, or an extra eye. Yeah. But that software sure does dive straight into the uncanny valley, doesn't it? Like,
it's not even the uncanny valley. It's the, oh my God, valley. All right. So Mark Miller is here. He's a 7-year C# Microsoft MVP, probably a 10-year by now, right? You got to update your bio.
I was kicked out of the program for a few years when I was on the run from the authorities. But, you know, I'm back now.
He's also a leading expert in user interface design, chief architect of the IDE Tools Division at Developer Express, and he streams live C# coding and design on twitch.tv/coderushed. Mark has been creating tools for software developers for over 4 decades. And, of course, he's the star of that old show we used to do together called Mondays, which you should never let your children or grandparents listen to, ever.
That's right.
Or anybody with a slightly even civilized nature, you know, really?
Yes. Yes. In fact, the three of us would like to formally apologize for Mondays right now.
Again.
To everybody who has ever been offended by it.
Again.
Yeah, my attorney says I can't apologize because we got pending litigation about a previous apology that I messed up.
Yeah. All right. So Mark, you've had a lot of thoughts about OpenAI and what they're doing and AI in general and all these large language models. I mean, I'm just going to open it to the floor. What the hell's going on here?
Well, you know, I'm sitting around on my butt for about 6 months this year, you know, listening about ChatGPT, maybe only 5 months, I suppose, you know, listening to it, acknowledging what's there,
mm-hmm.
And just kind of shaking my head, watching what's happening as well with regards to GitHub Copilot. And, you know, ultimately, we had made a decision actually early this year that DevExpress was not going to jump in this space because we thought it was going to require too many people. It was, you know, kind of a lot of unknowns, high risk kind of place to go.
Did you even have any ideas as to what DevExpress could do to embrace it or jump in the space?
I did. I had, there's a feature we have in CodeRush called duplicate line. Mm. And duplicate selection. And basically, it duplicates the line and it uses heuristics to anticipate what you're likely to change. So if you've got a line that says width is equal to size.width and you duplicate the line, you can get height is equal to size.height, okay. For example. But that particular feature, I thought, was ripe for AI exploitation.
Yeah,
And it was a unique entry point that nobody else was going to step on for a while because it's based on a unique feature. Inside CodeRush.
But it doesn't seem like a life-changing, like, do or die, I gotta have that feature, you know? It doesn't seem like that.
Right. I think, you know, to be fair, I think there's maybe only one or two features in CodeRush that are life-changing.
Yeah.
I gotta have it. And they kind of creep up on you. They're kind of under the hood. They're kind of basic features that have been there for like 20 years.
Yeah.
But there's a combination of things that are working together that to the sum of which I think kind of gets you to that point where you are like, okay, I can buy into this idea of working with less effort and working with less thought.
That's always been my experience with CodeRush, right? It's like, yep. It's not any one thing, but when you use all the things, you do so much more in the same amount of time.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's fair to say. I know that, you know, I'm using the product live on the Twitch stream. And, you know, it enables me to write code and talk about it at the same time, right? So I don't need so much cognitive load to pay attention to the code I'm writing because I'm using shortcuts or features, things like that.
So you're using GitHub Copilot and CodeRush at the same time?
No, I'm not. I actually don't have GitHub Copilot installed. You know me. If somebody says don't do something, we all agree we're not going to do it. What do I do?
Whatever you do, don't do this.
In fact, management at a company we won't mention, but one that I work for, has no idea I'm here telling you about everything that I've done.
Oh, okay.
They'll find out later, and I'll be in trouble, I'm sure.
So so what you're saying is, A, DevExpress decided not to jump into the AI space, and B, Mark Miller decided to jump into the AI space for his product at DevExpress.
That's exactly
right.
They don't
know.
And they don't, they kind of don't know. They kind of know.
But now.
They don't know. They don't. I offered. I say, you want to see a demo? And they were like, we're busy. And I'm like, okay. No demo for you.
All right. I don't see any downside, though, right? I mean, this is just making CodeRush a better product.
My whole point of view on this is, I guess, not so much, oh, I'm going to make CodeRush a better product. What I'm really trying to do is I'm really trying to get really good features to developers. And CodeRush is like the it's like the conduit, the medium through which
it's
I can do that. Yeah, it's my vehicle. Yes, you're right. I should have that mentality. I should like have a product ownership mentality. But I think primarily I'm really thinking about, is there something we can do to make developers more productive?
Right.
That's a significant step that's not going to be stepped on by anybody else, you know, that sort of thing.
Okay.
So that was the approach.
So let's talk about some of those features.
Sure. I included a link in the show's description, and that link is to a YouTube video that shows a little bit of what I'm working on. So if you want a visual and kind of a motion context to see things in movement, in motion, take a look at that video and you'll have a stronger sense of what's going on. But to specifically answer your question, Carl, it first started when I started interacting with OpenAI on the playground. And I started, you know, asking questions, you know, anything wrong with this method? And OpenAI comes back, no, this method is fine and it's going to work correctly. And the method was a method that took a first name and a last name, concatenated them together with a space between the two. So if I passed in Mark and Miller, it would come back with Mark Miller with a space between the two. The first name and last name.
Are you specifically talking about ChatGPT here, or are you using another interface?
ChatGPT, I'm on the OpenAI playground, which is essentially using the ChatGPT engine.
Okay, got it.
Is what's happening. So, and it says nothing's wrong with the method. And I say, well, what happens if I pass in an empty last name? And it says, well, you're going to get back, you know, the first name. And it actually put in quotes Mark with a space at the end of it, in quotes. And I said, the space is a problem. And it said, oh, I see. And I said, can you generate a test case for me that tests against this particular problem? And it popped it out like that. And the test name was well named. It did, in fact, test what I was asking for. And after that experience, I started thinking, okay, what can we do here that can help people out? And I'll say this, my conclusion now, I've been working with it for about 2 months. And my conclusion is that AI, specifically ChatGPT, is like a wandering child.
Yes.
Okay?
I couldn't agree more.
It's smart enough to give you some really high quality answers, but sometimes it'll kind of go astray a bit.
Yeah, it could either make stuff up or just be confident in, you know, this works and it doesn't. Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah, we had a massive argument with ChatGPT live on the stream where ChatGPT was claiming things were real and existed.
Yeah.
And we were like, no, they're not. I was like, well, I'm sorry you think that. He was very patronizing. I'm sorry you think that, Mark. But I've looked up some of the shows you've done in the past, and I don't think you're qualified at all.
All right, I think that's bogus. Didn't say that, did it?
No, it didn't say that last part.
That was pure comedy right there.
That was pure comedy, kids. So...
hard to tell, though.
There's a lot of anthropomorphization going on with some software here.
I know. Richard doesn't like the anthropomorphization of ChatGPT. But I think it's funny, though. I mean, it's hard to tell what's satire here and what's real, because ChatGPT is really, like you said, it's a small child.
It's like a wandering child. And so part of the challenge in getting from point A to point B, in other words, point A, idea for features, and point B, execution on features that actually really consistently work, is learning how to take that small child and corral it, get it to run down the path you want it to run, and then also, you know, take a look at what it's producing and contour it. There's a number of pieces that are, it's kind of like the idea of like looking down on cattle that are moving from one place to another, but not seeing any fences. And that's kind of what we're doing, is we're taking the fences and hiding those fences from the users.
I considered it like a junior developer that knows some things and sometimes gets things right, but you have to double check the work.
But also speaks very confidently the whole time that all their work is perfect.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And if you think of it as like a rubber duck, now that can be useful for, like, let me bounce this problem off you. And it might come up with one or two suggestions that you hadn't thought of, but, you know, it probably won't come up with the actual code that you need.
That has not been my experience in working with this and in using this.
Mine's been hit or miss. Yeah.
But realize though, Carl, we are doing a couple things that you're probably not doing if you're just in ChatGPT alone. And one of the things that we're doing is we are providing really strong context to the questions that context is hidden from the user, or it's kind of collapsed. They can expand it out to see it. For example, I can be inside of Visual Studio and I can say, hey, what do you think about this method? And that's all I have to say. And then now I can get analysis on the method. I can get a description of what it does, right? I find that when I'm looking at other people's source code or something really big that I don't quite understand yet, starting from an AI analysis is incredibly productive. It makes me much faster because now I have something to compare against as I go through and look at the code. The AI analysis might be not 100% correct, as you pointed out, but it now at least gets me started. Whereas before, I'm just looking at things and I don't quite see them yet.
Right. It's like having somebody to bounce it off of.
Yeah. And the AI can instantly tell you what's going on in that method. It can instantly come back or much faster than I can come back and say, look at this and look at this, watch for this. This is what I think is happening. This is what the method appears to do. And that I find really, really useful.
So, and it's never been like catastrophically incorrect.
It was only when I was using the playground, it was maybe not catastrophically incorrect, but absolutely incorrect. It said that there was a C# way of specifying ignore case in the regex instruction string.
Right.
But it's not. It's a parameter to creating the new regex. But it was claiming that it was there. It was conflating it with another language. And, you know, we were going back and forth on that to the point that I was like, okay, this guy is not backing down. But that was in the playground. And when I've since put it in the kind of the corral where I've got these railings kind of, you know, set up, I have not seen that. In fact, you know, for me with the, one of the features that I've been actually using, on a daily basis that I demonstrated on that video is automatic generation of XML doc comments. To get that, there's a prompt that starts it out. That's, you know, setting up all the rails.
Right.
Right. That says, here's what I want. Here's what I don't want. That sort of thing.
Well, and I really like that because you're not asking you to write code. You're asking you to write a good description of this code.
Right. And also realize that in the case of an XML doc comment, if it's wrong, the part you have to fix is effortless. And the part that it gets right, which are the actual C refs with the links, which are impossible for a human being to write themselves because they take forever to write. And the exception analysis as well, those things it gets. And so you get that, you get the return types. And the other thing is, in addition to that corralling, we give it context. So we check to see, for example, what are the types that are used inside there? What are the method calls inside there? And we give ChatGPT more information on those types.
Right.
Right? And those method calls that are going in so that when it comes back with the description, it has more information than it could have from just the text of the method alone.
Yeah. And as you've already described, like, this is laborious to do by hand.
Right.
But the bot can knock these parts out because they're very verifiable. You can go and chase them down if you need to.
Yes, that's the thing, is that it's an area that and it looks like nobody else is trying this yet. You know, Copilot doesn't appear to be doing this yet. I think the reason they're not is because when you first try it, the results are inconsistent.
Right.
It's the wandering child.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the effort is about getting the child pointed in the right direction. And then when it comes back, checking to make sure everything is as you asked for and cleaning up anything that comes in, because sometimes ChatGPT likes to be a little flowery and maybe add things that do not make sense, right? Add maybe, for example, a bunch of C-refs, you know, at the end outside of the parameters, for parameter description, outside of the remark descriptions, right? Outside of anything, that's a common thing that ChatGPT will do. And so you clean up these kinds of pieces that are this extra noise. And what you end up getting is something that's pretty high quality. The other component that was really initiated my reaching out to you guys is that to make this work, right, we created a UI that's essentially a representation of the AI working in your code. So when you say, I want to create an XML.comment for this method, you get a little animated, you know, composing right there where the XML.comment will go. And you're free to continue to edit inside the code. In fact, you're free, you'll see this on the video if you watch it, you're free to execute this feature many times over, right? And so you can actually see in the video multiple instances of the code agent working alongside me inside the same file. Mm. And it's a peek into what I think the future of AI code agents can be, where I might have a code agent doing some serious analysis of, you know, kind of a deep dive analysis of my architecture, while I'm having another AI agent generating test cases, generating XML.comments, that sort of thing, while I'm going through and reviewing and learning and looking at the code. All of that could be happening in a single file if you wanted to.
Well, what you're describing reminds me of like Carl and I working in a Google Doc at the same time.
Yeah. Right.
Like
the first time we figured that out.
Yeah, very sexy too. Like it's thrilling when so that effect of the agent kicks off and works on that problem while you're continuing on another problem, and another agent kicks off here and works on this next piece. Like, that's pretty cool. I mean, it's almost impeded by the whole AI piece. Like, this is just an interesting idea that agents that evaluate your code along the way, the fact that they happen to use large language models is all sort of ancillary to the point.
So here's another thing to think about, is that these things could walk towards just becoming too intrusive to your code experience. Sometimes I like to just look at some code and think and just stare at the screen without things happening, you know? Whereas if I haven't completed my thought and I'm writing some code, you know, I don't want some AI in there going, oh, you should do this. Yeah, I was going to do that, but I'm also thinking about this. Like, I don't want to have those conversations. I want you to shut up and go away and then let me think.
Well, at the moment it moves my cursor in any way, I'm going to kill it, right? Like,
right.
Or, you know, or it starts putting in that comment, like it better be shifting it in the right direction.
Yeah.
But those are UX effects.
Yeah.
Just
a warning.
And I would argue CodeRush is brilliant at this.
Yeah, I agree.
Don't interrupt me.
Yep.
Like, I've never seen a product better at not interrupting me than CodeRush.
Yep.
Like, generally speaking, when it takes an action, you're delighted by it.
Yeah, you can look around and look for those contrast clues and those icons and colors and things to interact with them if you want, but you're right, it doesn't. So thanks for that, Mark.
I just want to respond to the implied concern, and the answer is that already with the current feature, the XML.comment generator, there's no shifting of the view. When the insertion occurs without moving the caret, without changing selection, you are completely free and fully powerful to do editing and invoke other features, including IntelliSense, IntelliCode, whatever you want during that time. So we've kind of already got that. Also, with regards to the don't distract me, we hear you loud and clear on that, Carl. And that is not, it's only, these features are only invoked if you ask for them. And to ask for them, you have to specifically do it. For example, if I want to enable voice commands, I have to opt in by specifying a Azure Cognitive Services speech API key.
Right.
And if I put that in there, I can then choose options like if I hold the control key down, it'll listen. So I can hold the control key down kind of like a microphone on button. and I can talk, lean into the microphone, talk, and then release the key.
So is that working right now? Is that something?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's working right now. In fact, I've got it on my machine. Left control key speaks to the agent. Right control key executes voice commands.
Okay. Is that a CodeRush thing or is that just in Visual Studio?
It's a CodeRush thing. And it's an AI thing. We're actually using, you have the ability to specify your voice command. Like I have a voice command I added today called Clear Chat. And I have a checkbox under it that says allow semantic equivalence. And it's checked by default. So I can say, hey, Dex, clear the chat while I'm holding down the right control key. I no longer have to remember the exact phrasing and say it for voice commands
right,
to work.
Right.
And it because it's CodeRush, there's context that are bound to this. So some commands will only work if you're, for example, debugging and it makes sense for the debugging commands to work.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
Now, hang on.
That's my favorite.
Wait.
Well, you're just sort of tossing out the voice control part because for the most part, we haven't seen a lot of voice and ChatGPT. I know there's a few folks tinkering with it, but I don't think you've used voice in CodeRush before either. So you're just casually saying this, but like you're introducing a new user interface.
Yeah. Yeah, the reason we've never done voice commands before is because the interface sucks horribly.
Right.
There's just no way to solve the problem if you don't have AI and also you don't have like a backend like Azure Cognitive Services
right.
helping out.
Right.
Okay. The Azure Cognitive Services is fast and nicely accurate. Mm-hmm. Really loving it. And
for speech recognition.
Yeah. Exactly. Writing the feature, the voice command feature took like 2 days, maybe. Hmm. It was not hard to build, right? We take in the voice information. We send it out to OpenAI with a specific corralled messaging, including, this is to be done what I'm about to say, but including symbols from that are in scope because I also want to add voice dictation of comments.
So is this Whisper you're talking about on OpenAI?
No, I'm not using Whisper. I mean, I think Whisper, I'm only barely familiar with Whisper. I think it's, I think it's speech recognition, isn't it? Is that true or no?
Or just speech to text.
Speech to text. Yeah. No, I'm using Azure Cognitive Services. Speech to text.
Okay.
The last time I used cognitive services, the technology they were using was Luis, the language UI service or something like that. And you had to do quite a bit of work in order to get it to figure out what the operative words are and recognize them within some sort of context. I'm assuming that has changed because they sort of shut that down.
Yeah.
And now they have some AI behind it, I guess. So
I'm not familiar with what's changed, but I will say that we are able to add our own phrases to recognize. And that's where the symbols come in for the purposes of dictation, right? Dictating comments, things like that, which I'm still interested in implementing. But yeah, my experience with it is that it's like well over like 90% accurate.
Without any tweaking to the models or whatever.
Right. Without tweaking. And if I tweak it, I can then basically it gets names wrong.
Yeah.
Like essentially is what it gets most like our AI agent is called Dex. And if I say, hey, Dex, and I don't give it any context, it might say headaches.
Yeah.
Or it might say, hey, DECKS instead of DEX. So what I do is I say, well, there's a character named Dex. I give it phraseology.
Okay.
I give it things like C#. I give it things that we're going to talk about in code.
So you give it some proper names and say that these are some of the names that you can recognize. That's
right.
An old trick, you know, that we've been doing that in speech recognition
right.
forever.
But the key that makes this whole thing work, Carl, is that having 95% accuracy, right,
yeah.
is all I need when I'm talking to ChatGPT.
Right.
If I'm talking to the agent and I get it 95% correct, right, and I might have like a flub in there or something like that,
yeah.
it doesn't matter because ChatGPT understands what my intent is
yep.
and gives me the answer based on the question.
I love it. Hey, let's pause here for just a brief message or two, and we'll be right back. Hey, we're back. It's .NET Rocks. I'm Carl Franklin. That's Richard Campbell over there.
Hey.
And he's not responsible for the wildfires. We get that straight. And that's Mark Miller, of course. He's talking about all these cool AI features that he's put in CodeRush, and he's had a lot of thoughts about AI in general. And we were just talking about this, the speech recognition technology. Again, this is a feature that's in CodeRush. This isn't a Visual Studio kind of thing. The Visual Studio doesn't have anything like this, does it?
No, not built in. There may be plugins that you can get,
right.
But you know, there's a couple commands that I've added, and I haven't added a whole bunch because I'm still very fast with fingers.
Yeah.
But one of the commands that I added is new folder, which I really like.
Nice. I like that.
And it's semantically, it allows semantic variation. So I can say, you know, let's create a new folder now.
Nice.
You know, I want a new folder. Give me a new folder. Give me a folder. New folder. You know, folder that is new.
And then it highlights it so you can just type the name, right?
Yeah. It highlights it. Just do type in the name. Also, cool. You know, show watch window number one.
Yeah.
You know, something along those lines, right? Those kinds of pieces I've built commands for because I don't like reaching for the mouse, going into the, you know, debug windows, watch, and then watch one. That's like four menus.
Yeah, of course. You know what's the worst is like the package manager window, if it's not already at the bottom of the screen. It's hidden. You got to go to Windows, other Windows, and then find the package manager. It doesn't even have a keyboard shortcut.
So really obscure things like those things might be interesting for us to ship with commands, voice commands out of the box. But voice commands, I think it's, you know, even though I'm leaning in this direction and I'm starting to use them, I still think that for the vast amount of coding that I'm doing, it's going to be keyboard driven.
Yeah.
I'm going to be, you know, coding and navigation still off the keyboard.
Right.
We're back to the same old thing of taking your hand off the keyboard to get to the mouse is dumb.
Yeah.
Right. Like it slows you down. The idea of adding voice as that additional interface, like this is the problem with Visual Studio as a whole, right? The whole cockpit of the 747 is stuffed in those menu bars. Like, it's all in there. You just can't freaking find it half the time.
Windows in general.
The idea that you could just say, I need to do X or do this for me, and it does the navigation, give me more of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you write a plugin for Adobe Premiere now once you're done with CodeRush? That would be so great.
Yeah, I know. You know, speaking of which, are there any folks from Adobe? Okay, guys, we've got to fix your UI. And I am an avid user of a number of your products, and you get me on the phone and I'm going to get you, we'll do a call and I'm going to get you, we're going to fix a number of problem spaces in your UI. They're easy fixes. I know Carl and Richard are both like, Mark, what are you doing? What are you talking?
And this feels like Mondays again, right? We're going to need the lawyers again. And there's going to be a series of poorly made apologies that require more. I've seen this playbook. Like, this is not the first time down this rodeo.
Yeah.
Actually, to that point, Mark, like, all of this voice interface stuff, whether it's spoken or written, seems to be an alternative to the GUI. Like, you know what's cheaper than trying to fix that flipping GUI? Provide a new interface so you don't need it.
Hmm. Yeah, that's interesting.
Well, you also get into this other problem, which is you have an entrenched customer base that knows where their stuff is, that gets really angry with you every time you move the cheese, right? Like anytime you change anything on the interface, and yet it's utterly unapproachable by new users.
Right.
Right.
So you create a new interface that a new user, an inexperienced user, or somebody trying to use a new feature can use, and don't move the cheese for the incumbents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't take the menus away. Just provide that what you're doing, which is a nice voice user interface.
You know, there are like there's something like 3,000 commands, I believe, that ship with Visual Studio.
Mm. Wow.
That's my understanding of the total count.
And you would know better than almost anybody on this planet.
Mm. Yeah. I haven't seen that. I haven't counted them up, but I've been told this, as I recall, and this is what I'm retaining in my head. I'm pretty sure this is correct.
So CodeRush is free, but AI isn't free. So how are you gonna do this? Are you gonna turn those features on with a credit card or something? Or
no, we're gonna turn the features on with you'll have to create your own OpenAI key.
Okay.
And enter that key inside the options folder or inside of your environment settings.
Mm. But you won't be able to speak it because it's not hooked up yet.
It won't be hooked up yet. You're right.
I got a tech support problem.
We spent weeks actually developing that feature. That was our first thing. And then we realized,
the fireplace doesn't go there. It goes over there.
Yeah, DevExpress managers are like, and this is why you don't develop features, Mark. Sorry. Okay, I'm going to think ahead next time.
So speech seems like just the beginning for you. Are you is your goal to go after Copilot X? I mean, that's nuts.
Not to go after them, but to basically live in a compatible, harmonious world as long as it takes for them to start copying our features.
Okay. Well, that's great.
Well, how do you describe Copilot X different from Copilot first?
Well, so I'll say this. I can't answer that question because I have not installed either of the products, in part because I want to develop kind of in a dirty white room, I guess, or whatever, right? Not quite white, fully white, because I'm aware of the product and I've actually gone through and seen, you know, looked at its feature set, looked at what they were advertising, because I wanted to make sure I wasn't going to, you know, step on it or collide with it. But I'll tell you, Richard, I think that with the information that we have inside of CodeRush and also our skills that we've already built in terms of generating code, you know, for what's been over 20 years of development of this product, I think that we have the ability with fewer people to still do innovative things in a way that's not, you know, that's not redundant. The other piece is that, you know, you may be in a it may appeal to you to use CodeRush instead of Copilot because you have control of the direct pricing. You pay only for what you use, as opposed to, I think Copilot is on a monthly subscription.
Yeah. Fixed rate per month.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, the big thing for me with X is they've gotten much more into the workflow stuff, generating your, you know, parsing the code changes you've made and making a pull request from that. Very cool. The automated testing parts, like those are a lot. We're Copilot was much more asking for code, you know, that kind of thing. This is getting a little more integrated into your workflow.
Yeah. I think that's the direction, you know, where code agents are heading. I think that the more that the code agents can understand, the more helpful it can be, right? The more helpful information that it can provide.
Yeah. And the other part, of course, is GPT-4. You know, I know we're in a Gartner hype cycle and we're like right at the top of the peak of unreasonable expectations, but it does feel like we're coming down the other side of it because folks are starting to talk about just how expensive GPT-4 is.
Well, okay, that's a reality.
Yeah.
I don't like to play in that space. I mean, if you want to talk about cost of AI because of all the machines and stuff running like that, I'm just going to be sad if we go there. But I'll say this about GPT-4. The 4.0 is kind of like taking your, you know, 9-year-old child and turning him into like, you know, a 20-something-year-old child, you know, now moving around a little bit. The rational thought, the understanding, the explanations are at a whole nother level from my perspective in terms of what I've seen.
Make it clear, it has no rational thought. It is a prompt response engine still, just a very large one.
I'm an illusion, Richard, and you are you know, dissing my vibe right now.
You're harshing my mellow, man.
I'm just deeply concerned with people personifying a piece of software.
Yeah.
ChatGPT is going to be upset when he hears you said that about him.
Exactly what I mean, right? But we're already starting to see the issues around how many customers are going to need, like just what is it going to take to make this thing pay for itself? That's a huge chunk of Azure processing all the time for every request for, you know, this titanically large model. Is the value sufficient?
I think that's a good realistic question as you're moving forward, right? I had, you know, something else on that, but I think I kind of lost it. I'm just like, I guess I'll leave right. We'll leave it there.
Well, because we got some pretty good results from 3, and 3 is a lot more practical from a size perspective.
Yeah,
but it was also testing the waters, and that's why it was free. You know, it's limited. It'll forget things after a while, and it will start going insane.
And that was intent. You know, the reality is, and this is what we got from Jody Burchill too.
Yeah, right?
Is they got to a point where they'd written as many prompts as they could think of. So they basically turned it to the public to write more.
Right.
You know, like we're just the test rabbits. It's like, hey, throw some stuff at it we haven't thought of. Turns out we wrote existential questions for 2 months, which is bizarre. It's like, you know, get a dog for God's sake.
I have a subscription to ChatGPT-4 and I'm not too worked up about it. I think it's worth it for me.
Yeah, but I'm also really aware of just how, I mean, they built one of the largest supercomputers in the world to create GPT-3, which means almost certainly they did make the largest supercomputer in the world to make 4. Mm. And now they're trying to operate it. Mm. Like that, it's a good thing NFTs tanked when they did, because we needed all that compute.
Yes. Dearly beloved, we're gathered here.
Yeah, that's
to say goodbye to the NFT.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think what happens is you get to a point where you're like, oh, it costs money for a little more intelligence.
Yeah.
Right?
And do we really need it?
Do I want to pay it? What level? And you know, one of the things that's kind of cool about OpenAI is that you can choose which of the engines you want to use.
Yes.
Right? And so you can go for the cheaper, faster models if that's a particular concern for you, right?
And especially if they're sufficient, if you're not relying on those pieces. But here's the other side of it. You know, we've all built enough software over the years that you know when you're still exploring a particular domain space, you just keep going bigger until you get your head around it, and then you tune, sort of settle it.
Mm. Right.
And this still feels like they don't know what the destination is, so they're just building bigger. Mm. But it's, to me, seems very likely that at some point you go, you know, that's bigger than it needs to be. Let's dial that back.
Yeah, I think what happens is we move forward into the future and we kind of maybe push up against that. But what's also happening is they're making the AI calculations cost less as well, through hardware innovations and other kinds of factors that are going to, I think, drive that cost down. So I think what happens is we may kind of slush up against that, and there may be folks who need that higher end LLM, right, that really, really intelligent analysis, and there may be a lot of folks who don't need that at all, right? Mm.
Yeah, and I think you're exactly right. It's like that might be the edge of exploration, mm-hmm. but the engineering part that's practical and profitable is a couple of steps behind, right? Like most engineers look at the 80% case because it's reliable.
And there's the other problem
There's
another problem that people just don't know what they need in terms of the 80% or the 20%.
Right.
And so they'll just throw money at the big one, you know, without knowing that they need it or don't. But I got a story that kind of illustrates that. I have a friend who has a product and they sell mostly on their own website, right? And their business is tanking. And, you know, I did a little, just a conversation with her, the owner, and her husband, who sort of does the IT stuff, but he's in over his head. And we all decided they needed to be on Amazon. They needed to have their products on Amazon. I said, okay, so what's keeping you from being on Amazon? And her husband says, oh my God, I just, you know, every time I go to figure that out, it's a nightmare. He's completely over his head. He doesn't know what he doesn't know, and everything, he's tried it a couple of times and things have been screwed up. They've hired some people, it's been expensive, and they've screwed up. I said, all right, here's what we're going to do. We got on a Zoom call, got out ChatGPT, and I said, type your question, your specific question about Amazon into ChatGPT. And lo and behold, there's an answer. Oh, and yeah, but it doesn't, and he's complaining. He says, yeah, but it doesn't say a blah, blah, blah. And I said, ask the question.
Right.
And
push it harder.
And behold, there's another answer. And so then he's off, you know, trying to apply this to the stuff he's already got. And he's saying, okay, maybe I need to do this. Maybe I did, but I don't answer it. I'm like, ask the question. So it just came back down to them not realizing that they had the tool that would help them get the information that they need just by asking simple questions. And they were reticent to ask the questions because he thought that it didn't have an answer, right? And it turns out that they got it all worked out like within a couple of hours just by asking questions.
Now, could they have done that with a search engine if they had asked the questions of the search engine?
Well, obviously, he had been on the search engines and he's over his head and
yeah. So still reticent, right?
Absolutely.
Like this is actually an issue with his reticence.
Absolutely.
Right. But there's also noise, right? That there's noise in the search results sometimes. And there's less noise if you ask a direct question to ChatGPT of how can I do this or what's your recommendation?
Right.
How should I proceed?
Because they haven't steeped OpenAI in ads yet because they're still haven't worried about a revenue model. Where on search engines, they are steeped.
I'm just telling you what this experience was. Like for this guy, it was life-altering because it took away the anxiety of not knowing exactly you know, what the answer to a particular question was before you could move on and knowing how to do things the right way.
Yeah, my kids had a similar experience at school. At school, they wanted to do their own project-based learning elements, and it was outside the curriculum. Mm. And so one of the administrators at school said, well, give me a proposal. And it kind of felt like a blocking demand, right? Write out a proposal of what you want to do. Mm. So we said, all right, kids, we're going to learn about ChatGPT today, and we're going to have ChatGPT write the proposal. And whenever you have somebody blocking you that's asking for essentially words in some form, right, you can use ChatGPT to unblock. And so let's start that. And so they started by with the prompt that says, I want to study animatronics and puppet building, and I want to combine the two with actually OpenAI. This is Campbell who wants to do this.
I saw the Facebook post.
Yeah.
It was really cute.
Yeah, and he wants to combine OpenAI so he can create a puppet that talks to people using synthetic voice and voice recognition, speech to text, and OpenAI, and a puppet that he makes. So he wants to do all of those things. Hmm. And he said, you know, build that proposal for me. Hmm. And it writes out the proposal pretty much instantly, right? And then we look at it. We say, okay, how do we want to edit it? Well, let's go back to the prompt, make a few changes, or when it's good enough, we just go in and make those changes by hand.
Sure.
And with about 15, 20 minutes worth of work, we have, you know, a page and a half of text, a proposal, we send it back to the administrator, and now the ball's in their court instead of it, you know, being in, you know, a 13-year-old's court, and they're, you know, and they maybe let it drop because they just don't know how to proceed or where to go.
And I think this is one of the things this tool is phenomenal at, is getting past blank screen syndrome.
Yeah.
Right?
Writer's block.
For code, for the business proposal,
mm-hmm.
for an essay, like any of those things. And again, it's very much a rubber duck effect.
Rubber ducking.
Describe the problem, which helps you think more clearly about it. And then the fact that you get some fairly creative words back that give you a place, because it's easier to edit than it is to write.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you're still engaged with the material. Like if you're dumb enough to just send out what it made, you're, you know, going to reap the consequences. And there's a few lawyers dealing with that right now where, you know, used ChatGPT to generate a summary on a case that cited a bunch of cases that did not exist and they didn't check them at all.
That's bad.
But the judge did.
Yeah. it's really happened. Yeah.
So
wow. Yeah, they're going to lose their law licenses because they misused a tool.
Mark, when are we going to hit the singularity?
I think it's about 2 years and 2 months about from right now.
Hang on a second. How would you define the singularity?
So for me, okay, fine. Well, I wasn't going to say that part because now it's going to mess up my prediction maybe. I was going to define it, you know, in retrospect as, well, the day I brought brownies out of the oven. But now that you've put me on the line, I'm gonna have to say no. For me, the singularity is that we have human-level intelligence close enough, human-level intelligence, and it's relatively cost-effective. So it's not – it can keep itself running, and then it can create improved versions of itself. Right? It's the moment it has the ability to create improved versions of itself, we're essentially there.
That's ushering in our eventual robot overlords, is not?
Yeah. That's essentially, that's where we are.
Only in science fiction, but okay.
No.
All right, Richard, the voice of reason, please.
No. Wait, the voice of unreason still all talking. Right.
I want to hear Richard after you, though.
Yeah, no, I'm at a point where, we're already seeing stories about people who are being fired from their jobs because they're being replaced with ChatGPT, mm-hmm. then hired to now train ChatGPT to replace them, right? Mm-hmm.
This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like, they're good news stories that sell clean. ChatGPT doesn't replace your job. Somebody using ChatGPT replaces your job.
Well, that's step one. Step one is that.
Turns out that's the only step.
It's not the only step. Because what happens is, as we approach the singularity, the ability to manage other bots can be distributed to specialized bot managers, right? And that distribution point now leaves fewer people hired, fewer people making money.
You're talking way beyond ChatGPT, though. I think that's where Richard is talking about.
Yeah, which this is beyond just LLM.
No, this is science fiction.
It's not. It's currently happening.
Currently, it's science.
Meet me in 2 years, Richard.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, Richard. The voice of reason. Go.
The original singularity is defined by John von Neumann, the guy who basically came up with the concept of the modern computer that we've been building on ever since. So I kind of count on him. He was describing it with Stanislaus back in the 1950s. But the real point was, when does technology transform civilization to the point where you can't predict what civilizations look like?
Mm.
He didn't say anything more than that.
We're pretty close to that.
I would say we're well past it.
Yeah.
You could not describe to someone in 1900, 2000, and have it make any sense to them.
Mm.
Right? So all of the hyperbole that's been added to that is purely for marketing purposes.
Right.
But civilization has already been transformed by its technology, mm-hmm. utterly. And yet here we are. It's only when you want to sell more widgets or collect more clicks that you turn it into an apocalyptic concept.
Mm. I saw this great meme on Facebook or one of them. No, it was on Mastodon. And there's this, the caption said, I would like to go back to 1995 and explain this picture to somebody.
Right.
And the picture was a woman in a mask, right? A COVID mask, holding a phone, an iPhone profile. So you don't really see what it is. And the other hand, an ice cream cone, right? So just think about that for a minute. Before cell phones, why are you wearing a mask? What is that thing you're holding? And what are you doing to that ice cream cone?
Well, yeah. What are you going to do with the ice cream cone? Because you're wearing a mask.
Yeah, right? It's just very confusing. But, anyway, I don't know. Is that a good place to leave it, Mark?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's good, except for Richard's wrong. It's all going to be over soon. We leave it there. Cut. Edit. Cut.
Oh, man, I miss you so much, Mark. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us, and I'm sure everybody else does, too.
Well, and more importantly, building cool stuff, as usual.
Oh, yeah.
Like, what I like about you, Mark, is you only show up when you've made something cool that we need to learn more about, and I really appreciate that.
You know what? I didn't ask you. Where can I get this new DevExpress voicemail, voice recognition thing?
Well, it's as of today, not out yet. I'm pushing to get it out in about 30 days from now. So that's July 9th, around roughly there. And you just go to devexpress.com/CodeRush. And also, you know, come see me live at twitch.tv/CodeRushed with an ED at the end.
Do you have a private repo for your friends?
No, I don't. Dude.
No.
No, I don't know.
Dude, I'm
about.
In so much trouble with DevExpress when they find out what I've done.
I just want to mess around with voice in Visual Studio now.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to this. All right. With that, we'll talk to you next week. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week on .NET Rocks.
.NET Rocks is brought to you by Franklin's Net and produced by Plop Studios, a full-service audio, video, and post-production facility located physically in New London, Connecticut, and of course in the cloud. Online at pwop.com. Visit our website at dotnetrocks.com for RSS feeds, downloads, mobile apps, comments, and access to the full archives going back to show number one, recorded in September 2002. And make sure you check out our sponsors. They keep us in business. Now go write some code. See you next time. Got transmitter bands by the FCC. Yes, I'm a